Ma'am, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Nehal, for this warm introduction. And about me, if I have to say, I'm a very good student, hence I may be a good teacher. That's what I feel about myself. I'm a lifelong learner. All right. Now, quickly going to speak about national education policies, let me take you through the history. After the independence of India, actually, for the first time in 1968, a policy was drafted by Kothari Commission during 64 and 66, during the government of Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, and which was actually termed as radical restructuring, which was very important at that time. And there the focus was on development of a three language formula, that is Hindi, English, and a regional language, and Sanskrit for understanding our ancient culture, equal opportunities and the free and compulsory education up to 14 years, and teacher training, review after every 5 years. These were all the salient features of Kothari Education Commission, but somehow it was not completely implemented. Later in 1986, during the government of Rajiv Gandhi, he introduced a policy called as special, another education policy with special emphasis on the removal of disparities and to equalize the educational opportunity, especially for Indian women, SC and ST communities. And he spoke about social integration, gave a lot of scholarships and adult education opportunities for SC and ST. Teachers were recruited from this sector. And it was also kind of a child-centered approach in primary education and launched Operation Blackboard. So quite a few things were then. And one important thing what he did was about IGNO, that is providing the open university and providing opportunities for continual education. And he also spoke about, this government also spoke about rural university model. Later, again, implementation was not, it was not completely full-fledged, I would say. Later on, what happened, during 1982, this policy was again revised. And at that time, sorry, 1992, during PVR's government, PV Narasimha Rao's government, and in 2005, Manmohan Singh's government introduced a CET for professional courses like medicine and engineering. So why I give this history is there have been efforts by the government prevailing at that particular time to, enhance these policies and bring about sector. But I understand as soon as the independence was gained, there were so many other sectors to look into. So education may have taken little time or little effort, I would say. But right now we are fortunate, after 35 years, we have now much needed, national education policy during the leadership of our beloved Prime Minister Modi ji. And it was actually approved on 29 July 2020. And the cabinet approved this policy, and that has a great vision and mission, I would say. With clear roadmap, what makes this policy important is it's absolutely clear with all the timelines and how to proceed, and that makes it really, really, a transparent policy, I would say. And let me tell you, a lot of hard work has gone into this. It is not, it has not just happened in a day or two, because it's like 5 years consistent hard work and the transparency. I spoke about transparency. It has been to this extent that the feedback and the ideas are collected from each and every sector, all the stakeholders of education, right from gram panchayat schools, district schools, or, taking the entire 360 degree into consideration, they have taken all the things like, and also, of course, state government and central government are involved in the districts and NCERT, STERT. And not just that, in 2019, they reached out for public opinions. And all these public opinions were seriously considered. Lakhs of people gave their opinions, and then all those were reflected upon, and they have been implemented. And in fact, Ms. Anita Kerwal, the Secretary Department of Education and Literacy, MHRD, has explained the process of implementation of NEP 2020 in a webinar hosted by Nexus of Good that is available on YouTube. And you can actually log on to it and see it later. Now, right now, let me take you through the presentation. I'll be sharing a presentation and talking more about this policy. Okay, are you able to see the presentation, Neha? And
yes, we can.
So I'll go on the full slide view, then it will be clear. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So here we are talking about NEP, that is National Education Policy 2020. By MHRD, Government of India. Now, first of all, let us understand what is the vision of this policy. This window is interfering. Anyway, so what is the vision of this policy? Let us understand. The vision of this policy is to provide education that contributes to an equitable and vibrant, knowledgeable society. And for the first time, with other things like duties and responsibilities and skills and values, they are talking about global citizenship, which I think is a very, very important point over here. Because in today's world, it is not just about our state or our country. We are all global citizens. In fact, the entire globe is shrunken into one small village. And we all are, you know, the first the citizens of this globe also. So instilling this idea, I was really fascinated. This is actually the main thing insisted in international education, whether it is Cambridge education or IB curriculum. So global citizenship with local roots. They also say the same thing. So our policy says respect for diversity and local community. See, we can soar anywhere high in the sky, but we cannot forget our roots. That is the thing, and that is really a brilliant idea. Then the next thing is equity and inclusion. Of course, these are all the salient features, I would say. And the community participation, encouragement for philanthropy. Now, we need to understand, if we want to teach children about philanthropy, the first step is teach them about sharing and caring. And what is compassion? Always, children nowadays are growing up in a world where the focus is what I can get out of the situation, what others can do for me. So we have to change the dialogue, internal dialogue. Adults need to change the dialogue in themselves, and then we can affect it in the children. So, like, you know, how I can be useful and what I can give back. So then the idea of philanthropy comes, and I'm very glad this point is brought in and insisted upon here. And then there is emphasis on conceptual understanding rather than rote learning for the examinations. The Indian boards and all that, guessing the questions and answers, like a good teacher with 10 years experience can give you the entire question paper, expected questions, a set of questions. Why? Because there is a pattern of the board selecting. So many give reasons will be there, so many answers will be there, so many deductions will be there. So anything that is, you know, pattern is set and the answers are set and the questions are set, it's very easy to guess. So that is a kind of rote learning or memorizing. So typically children who scored 90%, 95% in their grade 10 examination, when they would go to, after the examination in a couple of months, they would be blank because that was crammed up only for the examination. So now by laying emphasis on conceptual understanding, it is going to be a permanent learning, like, you know, marks no more become very essential and there is no rote learning. And identifying unique capabilities, I'll be talking about it in the later slides. This is about identifying the gifted children and enhancing them. Every child is a gifted child, of course. But if we find that there are some prodigies and if the children are really good in something, we can really enhance that quality and then, you know, bring about a wonderful blossoming of that kid. And critical thinking and creativity, and also, like, you know, continuous review based on the sustained research and regular assessment by educational expert. This is another important thing that is looked into. Now, let us straightway go to see how will children learn. There is a lot of confusion and a lot of comments I've been hearing about this system also, but trust me, this is going to be a wonderful change that our policy is bringing in. Now the present existing structure is like 1 to 10 is considered as a proper formal schooling, and then, you know, two years of then HSE or whatever, CBSE or ICSE. So I would call it as a pre-college, like, you know, or pre-university course. Now also there are preschools and all. See, actually, when we are talking about this policy, we are addressing the problem of the entire India, or taking into consideration entire India. So entire India is 75% is a rural population. So we cannot be, we are sitting in a place like Mumbai, Bangalore, Kolkata, like whatever metropoles, and then we go to posh schools, and then there are a lot of AC classrooms, playgroup onwards the kids go to school. That is not the real picture what we are getting. Right now, what was happening is the government insisted that a child who enters grade 1 should be 6 years old. That was very simple. Nowhere it was stated that they will have to complete their nursery, then, you know, K1, K2, or your pre-KG and senior KG. Nowhere it was stated. So even when the RTE kids came for admission, whether they have gone to a school or whether they know anything, or whether there is a basic literacy, numeracy, nothing was taken into consideration. We have to admit them into grade 1. So 1 to 5 was primary. Again, up to, I think, around 85, 86, this fifth grade, which was earlier in the secondary section, was included in the primary section. Otherwise, earlier, 1 to 4 was primary, then 5, 6, 7 was middle school, and then 8, 9, 10 was high school. Then it was changed to 1 to 5 was primary, then 5, 6, 7, 8 was taken as, middle school, and then 9 and 10 as high school, and then plus 2 years. Now, what is happening with effect with new policy is it is split into 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 stage. Now, what do we mean by this? Earlier, as I mentioned, there was no insistence on preschooling. Now, it is compulsory that every child attends a preschool. Now, what are the preschool years? Your nursery, junior KG, senior KG, 3 years. Then they have pushed the primary 2 years, that is grade 1 and 2 is pushed along with the preschooling. So that they are calling it as 5 year period. And then after that, after you complete second, what is the next one? Third standard. So 3, 4, and 5 is taken as primary. Then after that, 6, 7, and 8 is another 3 years. That is a middle school, you can say. And then there is high school. High school, now there is a change. It is not just 9 and 10. Grade 11 and 12 also is brought into high school. Now, this is again very beautiful. The kids will see, actually, this policy is not going to affect a lot where already the schools are having grade 11 and 12. It is just, you know, rearranging the classes or calling the sections. That's all. Because most of the good schools, they already have the pre-KG onwards, like actually, in fact, playgroup onwards, the schooling begins. So for them, it doesn't make much of a difference. But if the school is equipped only till grade 10, okay, then the challenge, I'm not talking about the preschooling. Preschooling you can include and, you know, you can carry on. Like, but 11th and 12th, when it is brought back to high school, now there is a little bit of apprehension. Generally, schools have a tendency that, okay, our teachers are good and let them go and teach 11th and 12th also. See, I have headed the institution for almost 2 decades. I understand, with due respect to everybody, 11th and 12th, if you need to teach, you need to have a complete and thorough knowledge in that particular subject, because that is going to be a foundation for the next professional courses the children are going to take up. So either we have to equip the teachers, and if there are very good experienced teachers, no doubt, like, we can promote them to teach. Otherwise, we'll have to hire. So that is the only hiccup over here. But anyway, anything new introduced, no, is going to give initial hiccups, and we learn to live with it. But the policy is, again, really good. There is no problem with anything. Now, if we talk about, again, you know, like, what has actually happened. Universal Access to Early Childhood Care and Education, that is ECCE, this implementation is going to be jointly carried out by MHRD, that is Ministry of HRD. Now the MHRD, like, you know, our education sector is not going to be under MHRD. It's going to be under Ministry of Education. That is a major change again brought in with this policy. And then also Women and Child Development Forum, and then Health and Family Welfare and Tribal Affairs. So all these are jointly going to put in effort into the entire, you know, ECC, when they work out about ECC. Now, universal access to children of 3 to 6 years means free and safe and high quality ECC at Anganwadis or Balvatikas or preschools. For those who do not know what is Anganwadi, Anganwadi concept started as early as in 1975. It's a type of rural child care center as a part of Integrated Child Development Services program to combat child hunger and malnutrition. So actually it was, it just started as a primary healthcare center, I would say, educating masses about the health and hygiene and all those things, like, you know, because this in a way helped to control even the mortality rate in the infants and the kids. In 2013, about 13.3 lakh centers were provided, you know, Anganwadi centers were provided, and supplementary nutrition and then formal education, preschool education, some playway methods and all, they were followed. And nutrition and health education and immunization and health checkup were the major focus over here. And later, Mr. Anil Swarup, during his tenure as a school education and literacy secretary of India, I think that was in 2016 and 18, he took a great initiative of increasing the number of co-located Anganwadis. And sir also introduced a Samagra Shiksha scheme, which is still working very well. And now more and more such schemes are being added. And he has done a lot of work in this education sector. Now coming to foundational learning curriculum, that is FLC. 3 to 8 years are divided into two parts. This already we discussed. And actually what happens is there is a maximum brain development during this period up to 6 years of age. We will be talking about it in the next slide. Prior to the age of 5, every child will have to have a preparatory class or a Balvatika, that is a preschooling before grade 1 or class 1. And multiple pathways of learnings are there. Now, if we talk about dropout rates, the main aim is again to curtail and control these dropout rates. You will be surprised to know the number. There are about 2 crores of dropouts in our country. Everywhere in the world map, we are considered as a young country. Like, you know, India has got a lot of youth population and we are going to govern the world. That is what we are telling. But, you know, to bringing them back, that 2 crores of children who are out of school right now to formal education, and retaining them is going to be a Herculean task. And, you know, like, so many devoted teachers are there, passionate teachers are there, and they have been doing the work. One such example I would like to quote over here. There is a school in MP that's a tribal school, and hardly 100 children were enrolled in this school, and 50 also never turned up to school. So the teachers and principal, they were really worried how to bring back these children. And, you know, like, all these teachers, they took out some money, they poured in money from their own pockets, they painted the school and they converted into a kind of a railway bogies. Like, you know, 3 classrooms were converted as railway bogies, painting them with yellow and red and then writing. And they wrote a big board there, Khajuri Express. Soon in the tribal area, the whole thing, oh, school is converted into, you know, like a train, and Khajuri Junction, it became so popular. And the name of that principal is Santosh Uike. And then the, like, you know, from 50, the attendance increased to 87. So that is the success. And also, like, you know, we don't understand what is happening in the rural area. This was in 2019. And in 2019 itself, for the first time in Ludhiana, I think the name of the place is Sukhdev Nagar, Ludhiana. So for the first time, they conducted a parent-teacher meeting for the rural area, or tribal area. And it was something unheard of for them. And the parents were so happy. Children were so happy. So these are the baby steps we have to take, which are going to lead us to giant leaps, you know. And another thing about this policy is free and compulsory education up to the grade 12, it is said. Currently, insistence was up to grade 8, under RTE. Now we have to wait and watch how RTE is going to be affected by this thing. And again, in grade 9 to 12, there is a concept of core and extended. I'll be talking a little later and about the assessment and everything. Now, early childhood education learning in the formative years. See, actually, if you study the development of brain, after the child is born, of course, they are like sponge, they are absorbing. That's why humans take little time to stand up and little time to talk, but a lot of absorption is happening and brain development is happening. But up to the age of 5 or 6, the children have lot of capacity to build up their knowledge and knowledge base, because brain pathways, they just enhance. And at age 5, by the age 5, if the children are put into correct environments and all that, they can learn as many as 7 to 8 languages. This is what I had read in some of the researches years back. Now it may be even more. So, along with all other things, what we are thinking, arts and crafts and music, they are going to help. Now, this music right now in the international scenario, a lot of research is being done on music and movements. That is kinesthetic way of learning. So that is going to really bring in a good amount of learning and in a very proper way. So that is also again thought over here. The other things like, development of curiosity, logical thinking and problem solving, already we are doing in our small ways only. When you ask a child to solve a puzzle or a maze, then actually they are using their logic and they are using their problem solving capacities. But now, relationship with nature, I liked it very, very much over here. Rather than teaching children about herbs, shrubs and trees, why don't you take them out in the garden or to a site and then show what is herbs, shrubs and trees. So, I also like how the crop is grown and what is manure. So all this by experimental way, if you show in those formative years, children are going to really learn. And now among all other things you are seeing over here, teamwork, collaboration, that's all fine. Ethics is my favorite. Now, ethics, if we want to instill in children, we all adults around, whether it is teachers, parents, or anybody in the child's world, we need to stop double standard of behavior. We tell the children, you always have to speak truth and you can't tell lies, and we ourselves tell lies, then the children are going to get confused. Or if we lies means it's see like you know child is having doesn't want to go to a school, he's not in a mood, okay, fine, one day he can rest, but next day please don't send the note that my child was sick, he didn't come to school. So what the child is picking, it's okay to tell lies. Then we can't tell this child, okay, you have to always speak truth, don't tell lies. When they tell lies to us, we feel hurt. When we tell lies to others, it's okay. So those things we need to stop. So ethics are the most important thing, and ethics need not be practiced when you become a very big wig or big shot, or you're a bureaucrat, you're into a very big job, or become something or a big business tycoon. No, ethics are there right from very small things at home, and speaking out the truth and understanding and developing compassion and being transparent. So this is one thing which I really personally liked about it. And etiquette and behavior, already we are insisting in the school. So there is a focus again over here. Now, another sector is added, emotional development. This is a beautiful thing. Most of the time, as adults, we face problems because we don't know how to label our emotions. We are frustrated. We think that we are angry. Why that anger is there? Why that frustration is there? If we go to the root cause, the child should be first taught to label the emotions, then understand the emotions and also identify emotions in others so that we can grow emotionally intelligent. Now, recently, I did a course from Yale University about emotional intelligence of teachers, and it was a beautiful experience for me. There are so many techniques and tricks they taught us, and I really enjoyed the course. And I'm glad to share that I emerged as a top performer, top 1% of the performers. I'm still to get the certificate. Now, attainment of foundation literacy and numeracy, that is called as FLN. Now, among all this, I'm going to highlight on 3-4 things. Now, book promotion. See, national book promotion policy will be formulated and the public and school libraries will be expanded. you know, earlier in 60s and 70s or even earlier, there used to be a lot of public libraries. Today, they are unheard. See, we can accumulate a lot of books now, the digital content is there, but still public libraries have their own importance because they create an atmosphere. If you go to a public library, send the children or a high school children or middle school children, make it a habit to go and pick up a book and read. There actually, there is no distraction. Yeah, and everybody else is reading. So children develop the culture of reading. If that also comes into this, I'll be very, very happy. And then, of course, what is the meaning of FLN itself is focus on early reading, writing, and mathematics. See, if a child wants to read, first of all, they have to know the alphabets, they have to recognize the alphabets, they have to write the alphabets, and then the reading occurs. Once the reading is there and writing is there, then the children start understanding. That, you know, comprehension begins. And then, of course, mathematics. Mathematics is not just adding the numbers or subtracting the numbers. It is about logic. Like, you know, mathematics has to be taken up to high school. I am a very strong believer of this. It is not just children who want to pursue engineering later have to take mathematics. I disagree with that. Children require mathematics because it teaches you a lot of logic, a lot of patience, a lot of problem-solving capability. Now, 3-month play-based school. Now, there were a lot of comments about people actually see this new national education policy. The synopsis given is around 66 pages and the actual policy goes up to 300 plus pages. You need to sit and read if you want to talk about it or if you want to really understand it. There were a lot of comments made over here. 3 months play-based school before the before all children enter grade one, what do you mean? All the 3 years ka stuff can be taught in 3 months, blah, blah. Like, I don't know why people get into this. Now, if you look at the timelines, you will understand. We can't be leaving the children who have not gone to preschool. We can't tell them. Now, suppose, let us say, I'm just hypothetically talking. There are so many kids who are about 6 years of age who have never seen the school. Then are you going to enroll them in nursery? No, no, no. Now we have to go to nursery, then junior KG, senior KG, then come to grade one. Are you going to waste that 3 years in the children? No. The first batch, we have to make some provision. That is why this provision is there for such kids. So 3 months rigorous training for these kids and teaching them basic things. And then again, grade one and two also, the teachers have to really work hard to bring them up to that level. That is a different thing. So please don't misunderstand the policy. Read it is my request to you. Then again, National Repository is another very big step. Diksha, we'll be talking about it. And about a lot of school libraries and school books and digital libraries, all these things will be provided to achieve this FLN by grade three. By grade three means the children are ready for primary education. Why? Because now grade one and two, we have pushed it to preschooling. So grade three becomes a major step where children will enter into primary zone. Now curriculum is very well thought and curriculum, there is a reduction of curriculum. Reduction of curriculum does not mean compromise. All the concept, everything is clear. Wherever the NCERT and SCERT are designing these things, so wherever they feel, okay, there is a need to do this, there's no need to do that. So they will decide upon the topics and they're going to reduce the burden and no more rote learning because they will teach the core essentials which are really needed to be understood by the child. And also, like, you know, they will think of enhancing the critical thinking and then, you know, design thinking and, I mean, creative thinking, all these things will be there. And then, the classes are going to be absolutely interactive. Interactive classes where the child has the right to ask questions and right to think independently and experiential learning also. Now, quickly, I would like to give one small example over here. All other things you can see, competency-based education, then integration of the subjects is there, development of scientific temper. I would like to talk about how the pedagogy is going to change. Say, for example, in a traditional schooling, if a teacher is teaching a poem, so they will say, okay, the poet has said this, the poet has said that, and then, you know, even the question answers were given, the poet feels that, the poet, now the modern thinking is, how do you know what the poet feels? You should feel and then express your view. So POM is understanding what understanding you are getting and how you are going to relate it to your life. So it means the child is free to express what he understands, not what the poet has written or the teacher has explained. So this comes to concept like learning and creative thinking. So, and sometimes, you know, in international schools, we ask children, like, suppose the whole poem is read. So what do you think, if you are a poet, how are you going to, bring in the end? Or how do you want to change the entire scenario? So those kind of things will come into our curriculum right now. And then innovative pedagogy, like transformation of teaching learning process. Among this, like, you know, experiential learning, I already spoke about. Now, promotion of peer tutoring. This is very important. See, what happens is when a teacher teaches, we understand. But when our own friend, when our own benchmate or a classmate teaches, we understand it more because we feel more free, more connected with our peers. So this principle is very, very good, actually. So a classroom typically is a mixed bag. It is sometimes the kids are very bright, sometimes not so bright, some are struggling to understand. So it's a mixed bag. So if there are good children, like, you know, good in studies, good or bad, I'm not talking anything, like those who grasp very quickly, you can put those people with, you know, pair buddies, like a buddy learning system you can create. And peer tutoring means they can teach each other. Suppose a child is struggling, I finished the sum already, come on, like, what you understand? Oh, you have to do like this. The kids will understand. So this is another important step I liked about this. And then equal weightage for, you know, like the subjects. Now there are not going to be any watertight compartment as far as we consider these curricular, co-curricular and extracurricular activities. Earlier it used to be curricular activities means actual learning, and then it was extracurricular. Then in the mid 80s they removed that word extracurricular and they called it as co-curricular because they support the curriculum. Now with this policy, the concept is they are no more co-curricular. They are as good as curricular. They are taken along with. So that is another important thing. So freedom of choosing a variety of subject combination also is a very good move over here. And then I will talk about bagless days. See, in a year, about 10 days are going to be called as bagless days. Now, what does this mean? This is not for fun and frolic that children will come without bag and do some activity and go. No, these can be really, really utilized. Children can actually go for apprenticeship or, you know, they can go and learn the things, actual location. Suppose a child has taken up carpentry. There's no, like, you know, they, he can, those 10 days allotted over there, if the number of children is more, the you know, schools can call the, you know, actual professionals and make them learn. It could be a simple location like electrician or, you know, even mechanics or whatever kind of things the children have taken. Or if the children are learning really very, they are business oriented, then all they can be sent to business houses for training. So it depends, like, you know, on the situation, whatever the children have taken, school to school it differs. But this is going to be amazing. And also some of the days can be utilized only for learning through activities, lot of activities you do and then you learn the thing. Or business entrepreneurship can be taught. So bagless days are really a very, very good idea. Already actually in IB curriculum and in IGCC, we send the children, especially DP children, IBDP children, they are sent for a few days, like, you know, during the vacation we used to send, okay, 10 days you go and learn this and come and according to their passion. And even in Cambridge schools, but not all, few schools were doing that. But right now, if it comes into the system, this is very amazing for me. Now, examinations, if we're talking of examinations, there will be some census assessments in the key stages, that is 3, 5, and 8, to track the achievement of students. Now, why 3? As I explained earlier, the kids will have finished their preschooling up to grade 2 and then enter entry point at primary is going to be a very important thing. So grade 3 and then grade 5, that is end of primary, grade 8, end of middle school. And when they finish 9 and 10, of course, they will have their 10th grade examination, the public examination or the board examination. And then 12th, like, you know, 11 and 12, 12th examination, they will be there. So achievement of critical learning outcomes. Now, if we focus on learning outcomes, then teachers how to focus on learning objectives. Until and unless you have a learning objective, you cannot come to, you know, learning outcomes. You can't assess the learning outcomes. And then results of school examination. This again, I like. The result of school examination will be used only for developmental purposes. Now, in Cambridge, we have something called as checkpoint. These checkpoints are very clearly stated by Cambridge Board that these are not the, you know, assessments or to say that the child has done extremely well or bad or whatever. It's not, you know, assessing the children in that way, but these are only diagnostic tools. They call them diagnostic tools. It happens at grade 5 level and then it happens at the grade 8 level. One is a primary checkpoint, the other one is a second, I mean, lower secondary checkpoint. So by understanding where the children are lacking, we can guide them further. That is the purpose of diagnostic testing. The similar kind of thing is coming over here. I'm very happy about it. And also continuous monitoring and improvement of schooling system. See, now the examinations are never going to be to test the knowledge of children. It is rather to say how much they have understood, how much they have grasped, and what area they require more development. So that is a major step taken by the government. Now, reforming examinations in grade 9 to 12 also. This is, we are talking of high school and higher secondary school. And board exams are going to be much easier. Easier in the sense, they will check the core competencies or capacities rather than memorization. And then, you know, there will be different modules prepared like annual examination or, you know, semesters, etc. But again, the examinations will have two parts in it. One is the objective type, the other one is the descriptive type. This is currently happening in the international curriculum. So objective type will test how whether the children have really studied and thoroughly understood the concept. Objective type is not just calculating 1, 2, 3, okay, then blindly answering. But if you know, then they will be timed up. So if you know the stuff, you will be able to, 1 minute. I'm sorry, I had to cut them. All right, so I was talking about objective and descriptive type. Of course, for descriptive type, the children have to know properly, they will have studied properly. And the guidelines will be provided by NCERT and SERT and PARAK also. So teachers also will be prepared because for 22-23 session, academic session, teachers should know how to assess the things, assessment patterns. So they are going to train a crop of teachers also for this. And each school board shall ensure equivalence of academic standards also in learners' attainment. So this is again going to be uniform, whether it's a CBSE school, ICSE school, or a state board school. That is another big step. And beginning with mathematics, all the subjects could be offered at two levels. You know, two levels means actually one will be an see, in Cambridge, we call core and extended. But it could, in IB, it is called standard and higher. So whatever the case may be, whatever words you use, one will be to get, it is not the less or more. It will, the extended curriculum will be little more in, more added to it. Length and breadth will be little more. But in no way the core curriculum will be inferior. So that is how it is managed. Now this PARAK, that is performance of assessment, review and analysis of knowledge for holistic development. This body, National Center, has been set up to provide norms and guidances, guidelines for school boards through this body. Now, transforming the culture of assessment, the entire schooling system is going to be completely in a different mode now. There will be continuous tracking of the learners. Then board exams will be more flexible with assessment of essential skills. Then assessment of core concepts and higher order thinking skills also is taken. And AI-based, artificial intelligence-based software is going to be implemented to track the progress of the learners. And another thing is self-assessment and peer assessment. We spoke about peer tutoring. Now we are speaking about peer assessment. Now, what do we mean by this? First, let me explain what is self-assessment. Suppose you have written an essay or you have written a particular, see, this cannot happen for all the marks or all the papers, a section of that, you know. So you have written a particular essay or particular answer. So how do you assess yourself? There'll be great descriptors given, like, you know, okay, for four or whatever the ABC or 4-3-2, whatever the assessment pattern is there. So like you have to assess yourself where you stand. So clear descriptors are given. If you have made a spelling error, this, if you use a new word over here like this, or if you have solved it, the sum in a particular fashion like this. So based on that, you will assess yourself. Then there will be peer assessment for the same thing, what you have done, not for a different thing. So peer also will, assessment also will be there. So then combined effort will be taken. So if you are project thinking that you're too good, then your peer, like, how does he think? Does he think you equally good or somewhere near that? That will again give a clear picture. So this in fact may increase good bonding among the students and good understanding among the students. So only thing is, like, it should not go to a personal level. We have to make it very clear that, you know, you should be completely practical and completely, just for the sake of assessment, you have to do it with all the honesty. That's what we need to say. And then there'll be NTA, that is a national testing agency. It will work to offer high quality, good aptitude tests to eliminate the need of taking coaching classes. This is another move. See, right now, if you go in the market, you will come to know, like, IAS coaching center is different, engineering coaching center is different. If you want a medical exam, this is different. So all these things eventually, it doesn't happen immediately after the policy is introduced, these will disappear. No, they will again come out with a new ideas or to implement. But once this curriculum completely rolls out, maybe by 2030, everything is settled down, and that time you will not feel the need for any extra tutoring because everything will be provided in the school and during the school hours in the curriculum. Now, what are the highlights or key focus areas, if we were to say? See, focus on socio-economically disadvantaged groups. They are called as SEDGES, based on gender identities. This is basically women and transgender. Anita ma'am made this transgender, giving equal opportunity for transgenders, this idea actually came from the public opinion the committee collected before implementing this policy. And then, you know, socio-cultural identities, let's say SC, ST, and OBCs and minorities. And there are geographical identities also, like, you know, people from villages, small towns, and districts. And disabilities are there, including learning disabilities or physical challenges. Then socio-economic conditions, such as migrant communities and low-income group people and children who are in vulnerable situations, children who are victims of trafficking and orphans, including child beggars in urban areas and urban poor. So many things. So to provide equal opportunities for all these sectors, what I mentioned is going to be another key point. Then ensuring equity, that is equal opportunities for all whom I mentioned, focus on learning outcomes and declaring SEDS zones. Now, what do I mean by the SEDS zones? SEDS means special education zones. Based on the SEDGES, there will be SEDS zones declared, and in that SEDS zones, there'll be lot of facilities provided. There'll be fee waivers, there'll be additional schools, recruiting lot of school counselors. Why school counselors are required? School counselors are required because if the children are going through traumatized conditions, or they are traumatized for whatever reason I mentioned, whether it is poverty, whether it is sexual abuse, or whether it is a disability, whatever kind of thing they are going through, these counselors need to bring those children back to normalcy and convince them about education. That is why this is a beautiful thought, of the policymakers, that counselors are needed over here. And I am really happy about it. And gender sensitivity also is integral part of the curriculum. So gender inclusion fund, they are going to introduce gender inclusion fund, girls and transgenders, safety and rights, and bridging out this gender gap. Now see, girls, of course, every day I have stopped reading newspapers because it's only filled with negative news. Somebody every minute, every second, a minor or a child or a woman is raped. This is not a country which we dream of. We all have to fight for these kind of things. So apart from that, transgenders really, really go through hell of their life, I would say, because I don't have to explain what happens with these people. See, what happens is, it is not by choice that they are transgenders. Maybe there is some wiring or there is some chromosomal aberration or something. Ultimately, what happens is, if we don't include them into our mainstream and try to be compassionate towards them, they will become social evils. Like in the later sense, they may indulge into, you know, antisocial activities. Then we can't blame them. So this is another major step, that providing educational opportunities for transgenders would be a great idea. Then Parakh, already I have spoken about it. So they will be promoting critical thinking, and 21st century skills will be introduced into the classroom. Then online and digital platform, and a lot of pilot studies will be introduced. Again, this idea of pilot studies is currently practiced by Cambridge. So whenever any new concept is introduced or new subject is introduced, about 4 years back, they came out with a subject called as GP, Global Perspectives. So they selected few schools in every country and a pilot program was run. After it was successful, the whole thing was implemented. That is what is pilot study. I'm very happy that that is coming into our national education policy. Then adult education, of course, is a must. So, and lifelong learning is really, really critical. So like, you know, what they are going to focus in this adult education is critical life skills and FLN, that is foundation learning and literacy and numeracy. And then occasional skills and basic education, continuing education, and also, of course, digital infrastructure of knowledge sharing, that is Diksha, also is included. Now, another very, very important thing is CWSN, that is supporting children with special needs. Now, all the schools, like, you know, we don't deny the admission, we take the children, but our teachers most of the time are not really equipped to handle a Down syndrome child, or and the parents get very upset if the child is refused. So a lot of challenges are there. Now, if the teachers are going to be trained to handle this, I always used to tell children, like whenever there were very tough cases, I would request the parents, look here, our teachers will not be able to handle this particular case. Most of them we took whatever we could handle, but the parents were not convinced, because we have to understand already they are going through a mental trauma. So we can't say, sometimes the logic doesn't enter the head at all. So now if the teachers are going to be trained in this, this is a beautiful thing that is happening, you know. So enabling the mechanism and understanding them, and regular schooling children with the special needs will be integrated in the regular school. Now also, as I just mentioned, they are being introduced, but now modules, NIOs means, like, you know, open schools, what they will develop high quality modules to teach Indian sign language. This is another thing, like, you know, all the hearing impaired and all that, if our teachers little bit, if the child is not completely deaf, but they are having a hearing problem, if every teacher knows some sign language, at least they will be in a better position to make the child understand. That's what I feel. And certificate courses for pre-service and in-services teachers to become special educators. See, according to me, right now what happens is, there are special educators in the school who have done this SN program or special educational need program. So what happens is, if a child starts misbehaving, there is a behavioral problem, all teacher has to do is go to the counselor. And if the child is doing having a dysgraphia, they are writing D or D for B and B for D, this is a typical thing happens, go to the counselor or remedial educator. Because one remedial educator, one counselor is there in every school, I guess, like, you know, at least in the bigger towns and the metropoles. And then otherwise the child writes numbers, like instead of writing 21, he writes 12. So that is dyscalculia, go to the counselor. That should not be the case. If there is a certificate course like this to be announced for pre-service and in-service, I think every teacher has to qualify for this, so that I don't expect them to sit and do the remediation, but at least you will be in a better position to identify and help them in if the marginal difficulty the children are facing. And also, like, orientation to the parents, assistive devices, this is also a very important thing. Then alternative schools, like, you know, alternative forms of schools, they will be there for, you know, different pedagogical styles. If the child is unable to fit into the normal schooling, and such children can ultimately move to these kind of special schools. without any social stigma. So this is a very major leap. Then integrating vocational education at all levels. So Lokavidya Center is going to be developed and every child will learn something or the other. See, like, you know, practice-based curriculum. A practice-based curriculum for grade 6 to 8 will be appropriately designed. And there will be, of course, a skill gap analysis, like, you know, focus areas based on the skill gap analysis and the mapping of local opportunities will be done. And for that, again, skill framework need to be prepared. So that is under consideration. Then open distance learning mode, that is ODL, offered through open and distance learning mode. This is another important thing. And occasional crafts, like, you know, all students of grades from grade 6 to 8 will have to intern with a local occasional expert, such as it could be a carpenter, gardener, potter, artist, anything, like, or electrical mechanic, or, you know, car mechanic, whatever the kind of things their passion is, to develop occasional craft. And by 2025, at least 50% of the learners shall have exposure to vocational education. That is a current target. Now, this is my most favorite. Support for gifted students, students with special talents. See, what happens is, in a normal classroom, there are at least two or three kids who are really above average and their grasping is fantastic. And such children, and in fact, start disturbing all others because their grasping is much ahead of what the class is. So those kids, after they finish their task, they get bored and they start really doing. So I used to solve these kind of problems when I became a principal and director. I had my own ways of dealing with the solution. What I used to do is, I used to put some nice library books behind, one table was kept, and all, you know, activity books and puzzles and story books, anything and everything I would keep. So if a child is able to complete the task and if others are taking time, that child can quietly go behind and then sit and read. And that really worked with me. But now, encouraging such children, gifted children, to do more. So what is most important over here is pursue realm beyond the general school curriculum. This is fabulous. See, in earlier days, there used to be a concept of double promotion. If the child was very good, like, you know, for nursery, the school would decide, no, this kid is too smart and he knows the entire nursery curriculum, so they can go ahead with K1. That used to happen very way back, I think about 40 years back or 45 years back. But now the insistence that, you know, 6 years, the child has to complete six or B6 by grade one, push that double promotion concept back, because it is all age bound now. So 6 years means, there are children who had to, you know, go behind 1 year because they were falling short of 2 months or 3 months or 4 months for admission. So this is, again, I liked it. So these kids can be encouraged. So all other things are there, like Olympiads and project-based things and efforts for interventions in rural areas and extensive use of technology to encourage the gifted and talented. This is very good. And I'm sure even the rural areas, we are going to provide all this. And NCERT and NTC will be developing the guidelines for the education of gifted children. So I'm sure wherever NCERT gets involved, the work is thorough. Even when I started my career with a SSC school, even when I was teaching in a SSC school, I never depended only on the textbooks of what were prescribed. I always referred to NCERT textbooks also, because they really were giving a lot of information. And the BEd program to allow specialization in gifted educating the gifted children. So this is another thing, because again, everything comes back to teacher, the implementation. The teacher has to equip them herself or himself in such a way that they are able to really help the children. Like, you know, so the special guidelines will be given for them, how to deal with these gifted kids and how to encourage them and what could be done for them. Now, this is a holistic progress card. See, actually, entire child's only marks are not the only, identity of children. So it will be a kind of holistic and 360 degrees multi-dimensional report, you know. So progress card will include self assessment, peer assessment, and then teacher assessment, then of course marks. So it will be a kind of progress and uniqueness of learner that has to be done. Whether your child is compassionate, whether your child is friendly, whether your child is sly, whether your child is bullying, whether your child is timid, all these things, or whether your child is really good in expression, all these things will be reflecting on the card. So this will be a fabulous thing actually. And there'll be lot of all these things will be judged on so many things, project-based learning, quizzes, role plays, portfolio building, all these things will be done. So another thing is the holistic progress card is going to involve parents actively in their child's education and development. Then there will be also AI-based software to be developed to help track progress through the school years and help the students for their optimal career choice. So this will be a continuous, holistic progress card. It is not contained to 1 year. You need to track the progress of the kid the day he entered the school, whether it's a preschool, throughout the schooling, what have been the milestones the child has achieved, what has been the progress. See, a timid child in primary becoming in the lower secondary, coming and opening up and blossoming is a big achievement, major milestone. That's what we call as educational milestones. Then multilingualism and power of language learning. And there are a lot of advantages, of course, of learning different languages. I speak very comfortably in 10 different languages, and 4 or 5 I'm able to read. I don't know, it's a inner thing, like I grasp very quickly, I learn very quickly. But that, trust me, really creates a lot of bond with others, and you will be able to understand the other culture and all that. So this I really like. Now, medium of instruction up to grade 5 and preferably up to grade 8 and beyond will be home language or mother tongue or local language is the suggestion over here. Again, there were a lot of criticisms over here. But instead of criticizing, as I mentioned earlier, India is not metropolitan cities like Mumbai. It is a rural India where children come from homes. Most of the time, these kids are first-generation learners. Now, how are you going to combat this situation? So suddenly, if you start teaching everything in English, kid will go home and then whatever you have taught will be undone. So instead of that, English will be kept as a language and then it will be instruction will be through their own language. Here again, we may have some kind of problems because what happens is even in the rural areas, all the children may not speak the same language at home because there is a lot of mobility in the country. Even I'm not talking of the government employees or central government employees, transferable jobs. Even the workers, construction workers, for example, there are a lot of people coming from Andhra to Mumbai, from Maharashtra, they are going to Odisha. Odisha people are coming over here. So different things are, the population keeps on moving. So maybe then, local language would be a regional language would be an answer. So if you're in Maharashtra, so the kids, so how actually this goes out, I don't know. I read somewhere, in fact, Andhra Pradesh government took a call that after this policy was, before this policy came in only, I had read about it. So once this policy was ready and it was announced, they said that all the schools in Andhra Pradesh are going to be English medium schools. See, that is up to the states, every state, if you are capable of learning that. But the same thing may not work out in the tribal areas and remote interiors, there this language will work. Anyway. Now, the Language of India Fund project. I like this concept. When I was heading RBK International Academy, it's a complete IB school. We had a cultural club in IBDP. So there the children were free to connect to any culture of India or even abroad culture, whatever like we used to do. So languages also was one of the focus. And to that, to those children of IBDP, I have taken sessions to teach them basic Gujarati. I taught them Gujarati. I taught them, Bhojpuri. I taught them Kannada. It was a fun, I really enjoyed it. kids would pick up. See, they are not going to become masters or experts in those languages, but at least basic linguistic ability, basic how to greet and how to understand, that is good enough. So this is a very good one project. And then three languages will be decided by state. See, one of them is going to be English, then other one will be national language, Hindi. Then the third language, regional language, or Sanskrit. Like Sanskrit also has to be learned. In fact, somebody asked me, what is the use of learning Sanskrit? Nobody speaks. What our child is going to do? It means I just told, like, you know, I don't have any answers if this is your mode of thinking. Today, Sanskrit is introduced in all the Western countries. So many schools in the USA and the European countries, they are being focused on Sanskrit because we don't know what treasure we have in India. So whether it is your Bhagavad Katha, whether it is your Ramayana, whether it's your Mahabharata, whether it is Vedas or Upanishads, there is a storehouse of knowledge which unfortunately we are not able to access and crack because we are zero in Sanskrit. We don't understand. Some, like, you know, whenever any puja happens, we call the priests and they will say for us it is like rattling. No, please learn, like, something. Like, even if you don't want to take at school level, it's my earnest request for all the adults and children to learn some Sanskrit to understand our culture, this storehouse of knowledge. What kind of profound mathematical knowledge, astronomical knowledge, and scientific knowledge, medical knowledge is there? Like, you know, it is mind-blowing. So Sanskrit also should become a part of language learning. That is what is my personal opinion. Then this is again school complexes and clusters. They are coming with so many ideas, like, you know, Bal Bhavans will be established. You know already about Bal Bhavans. They are there right now, but the number will be increased and they will be more utilized, and Samajik Chetan Kendras to encourage, and promote certain voluntary activities and social and intellectual interactions. Then sharing of the resources, I liked this. To enable sharing of human and infrastructural resources. This can happen in small places like taluka places or district places or even rural places. If you have a very good art teacher, you should allow him or her to even go and teach in the next other schools, in the nearby schools, so that every child is going to get that benefit. That is what our sports teacher, this happens even for the academic subjects. An excellent maths teacher could be a faculty here also and there also. So how we are going to work out, we need to plan and implement this. And infrastructural sharing, of course, like now also, if you don't have a proper playground, some schools tie up with each other and then they take the advantage of their resources or facilities. This is another good thing. Then planning, development of short-term and long-term plans, like, you know, SDPs are on the consideration. And pairing of schools, twinning and pairing of one government school with other private school across the country. This we need to wait and watch how many private schools will be ready for this kind of pairing. If it happens, then it will be very good. Now we are coming to important aspect, that is teacher education. Teacher education is going to be, like, you know, for 4 years. B.Ed. initially, I did my B.Ed. for 1 year after in 1984, 85, I did my B.Ed. That time it was 1 year course. Now it is 2 year course. So right now, how they are going to do it is minimum 4 years, like, you know, for degree, minimum degree qualification for teaching, that includes the student teaching at local schools. By 2030, it will be only 4 year B.Ed. Course, nothing less than that. So understand this, this takes about a decade to implement the policy. So 2020, we have implemented the policy, or we have come out with a policy. By 2030, you know, certain things will be in place and we'll be all settled. You know, we'll have ironed out all the initial wrinkles and then we'll be fine to take off. So that is the thing. And there is also provision till then for 2 year B.Ed. program for all those people who have already got a bachelor's degree in a particular subject, but they want to become teachers. Then there is a 2 year B.Ed. program as it is right now. And again, there are postgraduate teachers who have already have masters in their subjects. They will have only 1 year B.Ed. program. But by 2030, we will be having only 4 year B.Ed. program. So And here we are going to include the time-tested techniques of pedagogy, then multi-level teaching and evaluation, and then teaching children with disabilities and teaching children with special interests, that is a gifted children we are talking about, and also using educational technology and the coming to, shift shift to learner-centered methodologies and child-focused education rather than teachers-focused and collaborative learning. All these new pedagogies will be a part of BEd program. So that is going to be implemented. Now, for improving teacher education, lot of things are in pipeline. As you can see, there'll be, first let's see, new and comprehensive educational model that will be by next year, that is 2021, it will be implemented. All the teacher education programs will be conducted with a composite multidisciplinary institutions. Then only educationally sound multidisciplinary integrated teacher education programs will be made available. There's not going to be any compromise in this. That's what they want to say. Then NTA testing will be there for BEd, and merit-based scholarships also are offered for four-year integrated BEd program. And then stringent action against substandard or standalone teacher institutions. So I don't want to explain on this. You're all well aware. So setting up of national mission of mentoring with a large pool of outstanding senior and retired faculty. This is another major thing. Once the teacher is 58, sending her home is not a good idea. By 58, people have matured and they have spent so many years in the field, and they will know. See, if you want to know about the cricket, ask the player who has played on the ground, not a person who has written book on that by interviewing. That's exactly the same. So teacher has spent so many years, so their experience speaks. They can come out with a solution. That presence of mind, how they dealt with the situation, it is unique for everybody. So I'm glad they have included this. Then National Higher Education Regulatory Council is to be set up. It will function as a single point of regulation for higher education sector, including teacher education. Then there'll be teacher eligibility tests also at all stages will be strengthened. Now, the next question comes about teacher recruitment and deployment, how this is going to happen. There is going to be a transfer, a transparent transfer system. This is wherever it is applicable. Everything will be computerized and online. Then there'll be TATs, that is teacher eligibility tests across the foundational, preparatory, middle and secondary stage, both in public and private schools. So this is another very good thing, the talent way is going to be recognized. Then tech-based planning for teacher recruitment. And then there will be certificate courses about teaching about gifted, teaching the gifted children or teaching children with disabilities. As I mentioned earlier, every teacher should aim to qualify at this. Then restructuring of NCT. This will be restructured according to the professional standard setting body and then General Education Council also. And test score and demonstration will be a part. See, it is not just that there'll be teacher eligibility test. And it's not only that test that determines a job for a teacher, but actual teaching has to be observed. Right now also, whenever we recruit a teacher, we ask for a demo lesson, but now it is going to be made compulsory. So then a classroom demonstration, and then decide whether she is fit to teach that particular class or whether she had to come back again after adequate preparation. Then empowering teachers, of course, career growths. One of the important things is there is going to be a teacher professional development, which they are calling it as continuous professional development, CPD. 50 hours of continuous development for a teacher is a must. So this we need to wait and watch how the private schools and government schools are going to do this. Then academic leadership positions also should be made available for the teachers. Right now in the aided schools and government schools, it is on the number of years of service, automatically they get promotion. I will be happy if they recognize the capability of leadership and then give opportunities for the teachers. Again, there should be something. I don't know how it is really going to work. And there'll be a career growth for a particular teacher, if a teacher is in the foundational or preparatory or middle stage, but if they are too good and if they can prove themselves, they can even be sent to secondary. So this also is another good thing. And it means a primary teacher who is also graduate sometimes and postgraduate sometimes need not retire as a primary teacher. She can, if she is ambitious, she can grow in her career path. That is what we say here. Then improving the service environment through better infrastructure at school. This, I would say, it is not just through better infrastructure for the teachers. There should be standard rules and regulations for everything for the teachers, right from their salaries, right from their leave policy, everything. Every school, I think, should have a teacher's handbook where clear-cut things are put in black and white. Sometimes what happens is it is at the whims and fancies of the schools. They change the rules overnight suddenly. That disturbs. It's not, I don't comment on that, but what happens is it disturbs the community. So that also should be brought in, I suppose. Then school leadership also, if 50 hours of CPD is there for the teachers and it is there for the leaders also. And these modules, actually, if a leader is capable, they can take these kind of workshops also, and they can systematically learn the latest pedagogies, and they can implement it to their own teachers, and they can conduct a CPD program for their teachers. So school leadership also is another important aspect considered over here. Now we are coming to the gist here. Best universities to set up campuses in other countries. This is a fabulous idea. If we have high performing Indian universities, they are encouraged to set up campuses in other countries. And in the similar way, all the other universities also can come to our India and then operate over here. This is a beautiful symbiotic relation, I would call. As it is now also, over the past decade or so, it has been a very encouraging thing that in India, for example, London School of Economics is functioning from Mumbai. So many other universities are there. Kids will learn 1 or 2 years over here and then they go there and get a dual degree. Sometimes they go and get a broadcast degree. Every parent may not be able to send the children for 4 years for undergraduate courses. Undergraduate courses abroad are very expensive. So for them, they are but ambitious. So what happens is it becomes a very easy thing. So 2 years of program you do here and 2 years you do there and get ultimately a foreign degree. That's a very good thing. Same thing happens for India also. So this is again another welcome thing. Then, e-content in regional languages. Now this again, actually Sanskrit is the best thing because Sanskrit pronunciation and writing is the same. So actually for coding and other things, Sanskrit is a beautiful language, but all of us Indians only, we don't know the language. Anyway, how the e-content is going to be developed in this regional language, we need to check. And coding is going to be taught in grade 6 onwards. See, actually what happens is today is an information age. We all are living in an information age. And we are having a lot of opportunities globally. So artificial intelligence coming into picture, machine learning coming into picture. This is not threat for humans. All these things have emerged out of human intelligence. But we should equip ourselves to learn how to manifest that and how to make use of that. So I'm very happy that coding is taught from grade 6 onwards. And under graded autonomy, academic and administrative financial autonomy will be given to all the affiliated colleges. And school complexes to be used for adult education courses after school hours. So that's also a very good thing. Then vocation I have already spoken about. And then the national testing agency, this also we have already covered. So there will be different levels. So NIOS and state open schools will also offer ABC levels, that is equivalent to grades 3, 5 and 8 of the formal school. And secondary education programs equivalent to grade 10 and 12. This is again very beautiful. Occasional education courses or programs and adult literacy and life enrichment programs are also designed. And then curriculum will be reduced. This already I have spoken. And high quality Indian sign language will be taught. And free boarding facilities for students of socioeconomically disadvantaged would be another great advantage. and then common regulatory body and NACs for accreditation. Now I think all the schools will be under scanner, so they will be periodically, you know, evaluated for their performance, and then done. And then three language formula we have spoken about. Then artificial intelligence, design thinking, holistic health and organic living, environmental education, then global citizenship education, all these are incorporated. Now the graduation, now going to higher education, to talk a little bit about higher education, graduation will be for 4 years after your grade 12. Currently we used to have 3 years, FY, SY and TY, right? Now it will be 4 years. So also there are multiple exit options. Suppose you did for 1 year graduation, but somehow you felt that the subject is not my cup of tea, I don't want to do it, I want to switch over. So you are not going to waste that 1 year, is not going to be a waste, you're going to get some certificate. So at, if you exit at 3 years also, you'll be getting a graduate, but you know, without research. If you do it for the fourth year, you'll be getting a full-fledged degree with, you know, 4 years degree with research as one of the components. This is again another very nice thing. I liked it because generally the research idea used to come in post-graduation or whenever you did postdoctoral studies, that is your PhD. But if the kids are going to learn it during their graduation, that is very, very good. And I would rather be very happy if it is brought down to 11th and 12th, some like, you know, research element. Like in the Cambridge schools and IB schools, we have in IB school a concept of extended essay. So their children actually pick up a topic and write it. Actually, a project report is an like, you know, research report only. So children know. So this will help them in applying for their foreign universities and everything. So that is what is about importance of research. And there was a degree called MPhil, if you, many of you must be knowing it. This was considered before, this was a preparatory stage for your PhD. Now that will be considered completely removed because it's not needed at all. As it is, the fourth year of graduation will have a research element that will ready the people if they want to go in for their post-graduation and then go ahead with directly, they can go for their PhD program. Now, so far for implementation of the policies, the government has, identified 305 tasks and they have been distributed, and it's a very, very well thought mechanism, and roadmap is absolutely clear, and there'll be redesigning of the textbooks, and there'll be, teacher trainings, and they're providing the resources. Everything is very well planned. Now, this is the most important thing, which I think most of you will be waiting for. What are the timelines, my child is in KG class, will he be affected? My child is already in ninth, will he be affected? So many questions parents keep asking me wherever they see me. So I thought I'll explain it on a common platform here. Now, if we talk about early childhood, that is ECC. See, initiating implementation of 1 year pre-primary school and 3 month preparatory module for grade one students. So you under this already I've explained, this is for already children who are 6 year old and who have not done any formal schooling. So for them, this will be the module which will be implemented in 2021 and 22. Then in 23 and 24, expansion of 1 year of pre-primary school through primary schools and Anganwadis. This will be done in phase two. Now, implementation of new curriculum and assessment. Next year, the children who are going to ninth, this is fair enough. Right now, they are completing their middle school and they will be going for their high school. So grade ninth, when they enter 2021-22, there will be implementation of new curriculum and new assessment. So we have one full year to manage the things and the teacher trainings and everything. Okay, that reminds me, I mentioned about Diksha. Diksha digital platform, the government announced, the secretary herself told that 95 lakhs teachers have already enrolled for the courses. See, every teacher is eager to learn, that we should appreciate. Already the work is in progress. It's not that one fine day the policy is implemented without anything. Everything is very systematically done. So naturally, these children, grade 9, when they go to grade 10, that is 22, 23, they will face the exam, what is according to the new pattern. Then grade 11, that is 20, 2023 and 24, they will be again the same batch. Then grade 12th new board examination in grade 12. So new examination pattern for grade 10 and grade 12 will be implemented. So in short, what you need to understand is next year children like 21, 22 batch of grade 9 is going to face the new curriculum. And don't worry about it. It will be very, very nicely implemented. So these are again the timelines. So first thing is formation of national curricular framework for school education that will be done in 21-22, and national curriculum framework for teacher education also is done in 21 and 22. As I told, everything is carefully thought about. And then 22-23, what will happen is teachers to be prepared for a transformation in the assessment system. See, we introduced a new policy, teachers should know how to teach. And we introduced a new pattern of examination. Teachers should know how to prepare the kids and how to assess the kids. So that is the reason. And then a common guiding set of national professional standards will be prepared for the teachers by 2022 and 23. Then in 2025 and 26, the target is at least 50% of the learners will have been exposed to vocational education in the schools and higher education system. Then state and UT governments to optimize resources through mechanisms to group or rationalize schools such as school complexes. This will happen by 2025-26. Now, you know, at this level, attaining universal FLN in all primary schools for the learners by grade 3. Fair enough, because 25-26, another 5 years we are having to achieve this target. Then in 29-30, earlier itself, I told it's a one decade of work is spread over a decade. It's not going to happen. Anything to implement, it's not going to happen. If the policy has taken 5 years to come into this kind of manifestation, the implementation will take 10 years naturally, and it will be done very thoroughly, because we can't be trying to hurry up with these things. And then it is like, you know, providing your plate with lot of attractive food. So many items are put and it's kept to you. If you going to eat slowly and as much as you can and then finish the entire plate, you're going to enjoy your meal, and then everything is going to be fabulous. If you want to hurry up and gulp down and finish the plate in 5 minutes, next day you'll have a tummy ache. That's exactly the thing. So it needs to be implemented slowly, gradually, and very nicely. So only educationally sound, multidisciplinary and integrated teacher education program shall be in force. And all TEIs will be converted into multidisciplinary institutes. This is a major step. Then teacher education will gradually be moved into multidisciplinary colleges and universities with minimum degree qualification of 4 years BA. This we discussed earlier also. That is by 2029 and 30. So universal provisioning of quality early child development care will have established this. So actually, then in the next decade, that is by 2040, we will be completely a transformed, we'll be having a transformed educational scenario in India. And that's going to be really, really a wonderful thing. So with the quickly changing employment landscape and global ecosystem, and it's absolutely critical that children not only learn, but more importantly, they learn how to learn. So NEP 2020 has incorporated critical thinking, problem solving, creative and multidisciplinary approach. And this is, ladies and gentlemen, a great beginning for us. And I really wholeheartedly thank the entire team of government, which is responsible for developing this policy and planning its implementation, and our Prime Minister, under whose leadership all these things are happening. Thank you so much. God bless.
Thank you, Dr. This was a very informative information that we have received regarding our new policy that is going to be implemented, as you said, from 2021. And what I have understood from the FAPE that the students presently in eighth grade now, that is now who are studying in eighth grade, and will be coming to the ninth grade in 21-22, will be the first batch to take in the implementation.
Yes, yes.
And Yes, so and for and ahead. Now the forum, I will open the forum for the participants. If they have any questions, your questions you can put on the chat, and our panelist Dr. Hoskari will be answering the same. Any participants, if you have your questions, please put it up on the chat.
Hey, can you share some? Any questions are there?
So I think we just received one which says, what about standard 10th board exams will be there next year for the state of Maharashtra?
What? Yeah, next year it should not be affected, because you know, the new policy is going to be implemented for children who are going to go to grade 9 next year. Means currently grade 8 batch is going to have a new thing. So this decision will come from the state government. But as far as my logic goes and my understanding goes, next year will be a regular examination for the present 9th graders who are going to grade 10. That shouldn't get affected.
Karan, do we have any more questions?
I did receive one. I've just done their 10th. When will they be availing this policy, the P policy?
See, again, you calculate it like that. Now, see, right now, if they have already finished their grade 12, there are different options. Even if the 11th and 12th, they have to do it in the normal, like whatever they had planned, whether it is ISC or whether it is IBDP, wherever they are. And later on, the graduation, when it is implemented, I have given clear-cut timelines. So if that policy is implemented, then they will face that four-year graduation. You calculate it backwards, no? Where your child is studying right now. The implementation guidelines I have given very clear.
So the clear understanding, if I can say to the parents, is that all those students who are presently in grade 8 will yes. have the implementation from next year, and rest of them who are in grade 9th or 10th or 11th at present will not be facing the new implementation.
How can they? Because until and unless it is brought in, we can't be pushing it down their throat. Na? That is my understanding. They will have a normal thing. I don't think there is any problem.
Yes. Yes. Any other questions?
So there's one more follow-up question which says, once the new policy is implemented, the standard 10th, will that not be the exit point from the school standpoint?
No. That is going to be taken away. 10th will not be an exit point. This point, if you listen to me, I already mentioned that it's going to be a program of 12 years now. The schooling itself is going to be 12 years. It's no more 10 years. It's not from grade 1 to 10. It will be grade 1 to 12. That is where I even express my concern. How the, because see, actually what happens is right now many schools will be there. They are running multiple divisions like A, B, C, D, E also some schools. Some schools may be having two divisions, whatever may be the thing. But what happens is when you have to increase your, grade 11 and 12 also to be added, it means first thing comes is the infrastructure. If you are a two-division school, if you have to have a minimum 4 classrooms. If you are a 10-division school, you will have to have 20 classrooms. I'm just giving random examples. So that need to be thought, and then also human resource and the teachers who can teach that. So how they are going to manage this, I don't know. Maybe they will work out something with if you don't have infrastructure, still it can be worked out. You could make the school in shifts. But 11th and 12th will be a part of schooling program. It will no more be attached to school. Say, for example, right now, after our kids finish their 10th, they would rush to different sorts of colleges. They would go to Xavier's, they would go to KC, they would go to Ruya, they would go to Ruparel. It will not be there at all, because schooling itself is going to be 12 years.
I think those were the questions we had. There was one more follow-up question. The students of 9th next year will be in school till they are 12th standard?
Yeah, it should be because 9 and 10 they will do. Again, see, this is a very tricky question, I would say. As I just now mentioned, the institution also will face the challenges to enhance their resources, human resources and physical resources. If they are able to do it, then definitely they have to be there for 11 and 12 in their school only. So it depends. Or at least they will shift to some other school which is having. So I don't know immediately whether they are going to bring, I mean, you know, stop the colleges from taking the junior college section, or they will allow it for a couple of years. We need to wait and watch.
Okay, and would this be policy across all the boards like CBSE, SSE and ICSE in tandem?
Yes. See, it will be for all your CBSE schools, ICSE schools and SSE schools. All of them will be under, everything, teaching pattern will be the same. See, actually, this policy, as I told you, the abridged version is about 66 pages. And if you go to the entire policy, it is 300 plus pages. I couldn't bring out, I tried my best to squeeze in a lot of things because the slot given to me was 1.5 hours. So I tried my best. Now there is a lot of flexibility for selecting the subjects also. Currently, we have some flexibility in ICSE, but there were compartments like, you know, science stream is different and the commerce stream is different. Now that is removed. If your child is very good in maths and physics, but he loves English literature, they can take English literature. Or if your child is taking physics and, you know, chemistry, then ITC. But if he wants to, if he loves history, he's allowed to take history. Or if he wants to pursue visual arts. So there are not going to be watertight compartments. I mentioned it, but I didn't get into the details. So there is a lot of choice of subject combination. And this cannot be happening only in the state schools, only in ICSE schools. So they are bringing it common, like, you know, all types of schools will follow the same system. A lot of combinations will be encouraged and the children can opt for it. Or a child who is science oriented, but ultimately he is from a business family. He wants to get into business or she wants to get into business. Why not? So the children can select all their science subject, take business studies or take economics. So these kind of combinations are currently allowed in the Cambridge curriculum and international baccalaureate curriculum. Now this is coming to our national curriculum also. All the three boards, what you mentioned, CBSE, ICSE and state boards will have the same pattern. So it will be all common thing.
Okay. And what about junior college teachers of standard 11th and 12th? Will they be teaching in school now?
See, I don't know. This is actually a compartmentalization has happened like this, that there are teachers who are junior college teachers who are never given opportunities into mainstream of teaching, that is undergraduates. Obviously, if the junior college shifts to, schools, they will be looking out for the opportunities, or if they are good enough, they may get into the higher stream. They may get into undergraduate courses, that is FYB, SY, like, you know, regular graduation level, really they can. But definitely they will have to move back. Now, wherever 11th and 12th is happening, they will be moving back.
So then technically they won't be separate junior college?
Yeah, they won't be separate junior college. It will be, the idea of the government is by 2030, all the schools will be well equipped to take the classes right from nursery, that is a preschooling, up to grade 12. Now it is happening only in few schools, you know, but now it will be made compulsory for all the schools. Whether it's a government school, whether it's a municipal school, whether it is a state board school, ICSE and CBSE, the schools need to work on that. There's a lot of work, as I said, and they are really, really putting in a lot of effort in making this success.
Gaurav, I think that was the last question I see in the chat or the Q&A window. Any other questions, folks? No, I think that was the last one.
Last question. Okay, Karan. I think, ma'am, you have explained in quite detail and the understanding of how the implementation, rather, what will be the years of schooling for our kids starting from the primary or rather the nursery that we talk about and up till the grade 12th. And your slides were also very informative. And we will be sharing this information with our participants. If you need to, you can get in touch with us. And ma'am, if you would like to share your contact for any of the parents to contact you on certain advices, you are free to do so. So whatever contact if you would like to.
I will just give my email ID.
Yeah. Ma'am, you can put it on the chat so that they can.
I am already doing.
So here we have ma'am's email ID for all of you. If you need anything for any other advice and consultation, you can just mail to her and she'll get back to you. Karan, thank you so much for supporting us for this webinar, because this is what the future of India is going to be with our kids coming on with the new policy, getting educated in the new type of thought process that we have spoken today. And thank you, our participants. Ma'am, thank you once again for being with us today on this webinar.
Thank you, Nehal. It was a really great opportunity. So many people connected, because people used to ask a lot of individual questions. I have earlier also taken, I was a panelist for this NAP and how it is going to be implemented. But today I am very satisfied because I could take through the entire thing. But as I again said, it's so vast, and but I couldn't take everything. But gist is completely taken, and especially what is needed for school education, I have focused a lot. And trust me, see, initially any change or any policy or any introduction is going to be a little bit of uncomfortable, because it's a rule of nature. Any change, like, you know, even one season switches over and another season comes in, we are a little bit disturbed. But I would, tell the viewers, there is no worry, no need to get worried about anything. You just trust the policy and the policy makers and the implementation, and this is in safe hands and it's happening beautifully. And I am really impressed the way the government is working about this. The timelines are clear, the roadmap is clear, the ideas are fabulous, and our NEP is on par with all the international curricula. That is the most important thing, and I'm sure all of us are going to see new India and well-equipped India, and we will be really proud of our own kids learning so much over here. So that's what I would say. Thank you so much for inviting me to give this talk. God bless you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you once again to everybody. And if we have any more questions, last 2 minutes, or we can call off the session for today.
No, I think we are good. No more questions.
Okay. So thank you once again to everyone. And we call off this webinar for today's session. We close the session today. Thank you.
Thank you,
viewers. Thanks. Thank you.